Good evening, everyone. My name is Benedict Klecka, Executive Director of the Redwood Library, and I want to welcome you once again to a fantastic evening of classical music with Professor Ed Markward, who he's one of these people, you know, he's one of my favorite people around the Redwood Library. So devoted to the material, so knowledgeable, and he wears his eminence so lightly. He's really a model for us all. This evening, it will be Handel's Messiah, appropriate for the moment. Now, I want to remind everyone that if you have any sound issues, we've had in the last two times certain technical problems, so please excuse us if you have any issues. Go up to the help button up top on the right, and for sound problems, you would hit the compatibility button. We will also have questions that we are eager to answer, of course, and Mr. Markward will answer them. You can ask them in two ways. You can type them in on the lower right, that where it says say something nice, or else at the ask a question button down at the lower center right. All right, so without further ado, I want to welcome everyone and thank you. Don't ever forget that afterwards, if later you want to replay the event, you can get on our YouTube channel. And boy, I would be most appreciative if you wouldn't mind subscribing. And if you're not a Redwood member, now's the time. So without further ado, here's Professor Markward. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Wonderful introduction. I will try to live up to your encomiums. This talk this evening began as a letter to the Rhode Island College Chorus in the fall of 1978, which was the first occasion of our performing this great work together. And I've been rewriting this letter in one form or another ever since. I believe it's 42 years now. Like any other great masterpiece, it requires attention and rethinking all the time and tinkering, if you will. I remember very well a board meeting of the Civic Chorale, Rhode Island Civic Chorale and Orchestra, several years ago in the summer, and we were about to do Messiah that fall. It was a Messiah season, as we all called it. And a member of the soprano section says, "I just can't wait to see what you do to this piece this year." I think there was a certain amount of sarcasm involved. Although I've conducted this work around 25 times in the last 40-some years, each day that I would open this score, and I think my wife Diana can attest to it, she wanders by every now and then and says, "Don't you think you know it yet?" There's a new discovery, a new delight to be found within this great score. And I've had the privilege of performing this work as a chorister, as a young man in my late teens and early 20s, as a soloist, first in Rhode Island when I first came here as a soloist with the Rhode Island Civic Chorale and Orchestra in 1975, and in full and partial performances, and in those which were superbly done, and those which tried very hard, if inadvertently, to destroy this great work. I firmly believe that Messiah should be a part of every musician's musical soul, and that music only lives through performances. As a performer or a member of an audience, it does not live in textbooks, or as I wrote at the time, on CDs. I think we have to change that to streaming these days. Lawrence Gilman, an early 20th century American musicologist and critic, wrote, "The characteristic trait of all authentic masterpieces is their capacity for infinite self-renewal." And I think this trait is probably no more clearly evidenced than in over the 2.5 centuries of Messiah performances. Gilman goes on to say, "It has overcome, and in the most literal sense, survived performances that set out to bury it. It has put up with presentations that observed the letter and lost the spirit, and with many more that somehow found the spirit without observing more than a minimum of the letter. It has influenced and repelled. It has created styles and crushed minor talents. To some, it has represented religion personified. to others religious art, and yet to others art. To some, it has represented religion personified. For some, it has been made hateful by distortion, by overuse, by sheer boredom. Alex Ross wrote several years ago in the New Yorker magazine that during the Advent season in New York City, there were 25 individual performances of Messiah within a 2-week period, and he said he became bored after a while. For others, it has been the one artwork, the regular consumption of which was their primary contact with great music. I'm back to Lawrence Gilman, by the way. And for others still, who had avoided hearing it until conditions were likely to be right, it has proved revelatory. I think of George Bernard Shaw's great comment, "Most of us would like to hear it done well once before we die." All these things and more Messiah has been and continues to be. It takes a work of extraordinary substance to exert such perennial power over mankind. Beethoven, whose birthday we celebrate today, 250 years, wrote, "Handel is the unqualified master of masters. Go and learn to produce such great effects by such modest means." Of the many tracks that I could take in this talk, after some background information, I'd like to show you how the Messiah is made up of various scenes throughout the work, and that these scenes are connected by text to each other and within each other, by text and by key relationships. Therefore, I think it behooves us to hear or perform Messiah as a total artwork, much as we would an opera, with minimal cuts so that we can get the entire thread of the work. Charles Jennens, the librettist, sent Handel the libretto in 1741 and urged Handel to put all of his talent into composing the music for this oratorio. Now, what is an oratorio? An oratorio is comparable to an opera without staging, without scenery, without acting, without costumes. And it is usually set to a religious or sacred text, such as this is. Handel wrote 23 such oratorios during his lifetime. Messiah, for instance, is about 2¾ long, so it's roughly the same length as a Mozart opera. Contrast it with St. Matthew Passion of J.S. Bach, which is about a half hour beyond 3 hours. So it's a long sit in any case, or a long stretch for the bow arms or for the voices. Handel's background, he was a successful opera composer. Most of you know, I'm sure, that he was born in 1685, the same year as Johann Sebastian Bach and, incidentally, Domenico Scarlatti. So 1685 was a banner year for composers in the Baroque era. He died in 1759. He was a successful opera composer, and he composed in Germany, Italy, and finally settled in England from about 1712 and wrote over 15 operas in the Italian style. Why did he turn to oratorio? Excuse me. It became a burden on him and the company financially to produce Italian operas. To bring in the singers from Italy, which were the only ones he trusted to sing Italian opera. There was no such thing at the time as English opera. It became expensive, plus he imported the players who knew how to play this particular genre. And at the same time, the public began to attend performances of works and prefer performances of works in English, such as John Gay's and Samuel Pepp Push's The Beggar's Opera, which is a Baroque piece in which there is acting and singing, and it is and spoken word. It is much like today's modern musical or a G&S work, Gilbert and Sullivan. That opera, it's a forerunner to what many of you may know as the Threepenny Opera by Bertolt Brecht and Kurt Weill. That took place in about 1728, and from then on, pickings got rather slim for Handel. It took an emotional toll as well as a financial toll on Handel. And as an entrepreneur and not an employee of the church or the state, the opera was not paying off. And oratorio was really far cheaper. Also, and this is a syndrome that we run into in this country in our modern day as well, the local soloists were cheaper than imported Italian singers. And as I said, English language was much more popular. Between 1705 and 1741, a relatively short period of time, he wrote 42 musical dramas. And he returned to opera only one more time after Messiah, and that was in 1750 when he wrote Alceste. Messiah was the 11th of 23 oratorios. Esther and Israel and Egypt are among those preceding Messiah. He usually set the Old Testament characters in his oratorios, such as Samson, Judas Maccabeus, Saul, and as I mentioned, Israel and Egypt and Esther. Messiah was composed or recomposed in about 3 weeks, from August 22nd to September 15th in 1741. Now, I say recomposed because about a third of Messiah is comprised of pieces which either Handel or someone else had written earlier. When we talked about J.S. Bach some time ago, we mentioned a thing called parody, and that is taking music which was written for a set text and applying it to another setting. In the case of J.S. Bach, the first chorus of the Christmas oratorio was from a totally different kind of cantata, and he used the music from that and set it to new words. Handel did the same thing. The great chorus, For Unto Us a Child Is Born, was actually an Italian duet from an opera for two sopranos. And when you listen to the Hallelujah chorus, the big strain, For the Lord God Omnipotent Reigneth, that scalar melody that we all love and know so well, was actually written by Arcangelo Corelli and was used as the basis for a fugue by Corelli. The first performances of Messiah took place in Dublin on the 13th of April, 1742. And it's important to note that in Handel's mind and all during his lifetime and sometime later, Messiah was considered a Lenten or Easter work of art, not a Christmas work of art. And as was usual for Handel in those days, many of his performances took place as charity performances. In this case, it was for a debtor's prison in Dublin, and Handel was invited to give a series of concerts there. There was a preview of this concert of Messiah on the day before, and it was so well attended that before the real performance, signs were posted around Dublin: women, do not wear hoops under your skirts, and men, leave your swords at home, because it's going to be really a full audience. And there have been estimates that it's either from anywhere from 600 to 800 people attended that first performance. It took place in the Great Hall, a concert hall in Dublin, not in a church. Messiah is not intended to be any part of a service. Contrast that to St. Matthew or St. John Passion of J.S. Bach or the Christmas Oratorio of J.S. Bach, which are all parts of services in the Lutheran Church. In this case, the performances in Dublin are like a Broadway tryout. And it was next performed the following year, again during the Lenten season in London, and thereafter every year until Handel's death. There are other reasons other than the trying out of this work for it to be performed in Dublin. Messiah is unorthodox in that there is no plot and there are no real characters. As a matter of fact, it's much like the Brahms German Requiem, and that Jesus is not really mentioned at all. There are no characters, no plot, and it's a series of connected texts or meditations or an idea. The chorus also plays an extraordinarily large part in this particular work vis-a-vis any of the other oratorios that Handel wrote. The text was prepared by Jennings from the King James Bible and the Book of Common Prayer in the Anglican Church. Messiah is divided into three parts, as you probably know. The first is the prophecy, mostly from Isaiah. The second part is the exaltation of Christ's sacrifice. And the third part is the life to come, principally from the Book of Revelations. It's interesting that most of Messiah, two-thirds of the text, is from the Old Testament and has to do with either prophecy of the coming of Messiah, or there are what are called types and antitypes, types in the Old Testament and their antitypes in the New Testament. A clear example given by Paul in his letters was that Adam was the type and Jesus was the antitype. It's spelled A-N-T-I, but it does not mean against, it means before. The performance in London was not as well received as the one in Dublin. The subject matter was not suited for a theater performance, and certainly it could not be performed in a church. It was referred to as a new sacred oratorio. The title Messiah was not attached until 1749. And then in 1750, Handel began the yearly performances at the Foundling Hospital for orphans and wayward children. And he conducted 36 performances, most again for charity. What I would like to do now is begin exploring how this work is put together. Before that, I should tell you that the idea or the notion that this became a Christmas piece springs from the Handel Haydn Society right here in New England, in Boston. It was founded in 1815, and during the Christmas season of that year, shortly after its founding, the Handel Haydn Society gave its first concert. And among the offerings on that concert were selections from Messiah. In 1818, the first full performance of this oratorio in the United States was given by H&H on Christmas Day. And therefore, a new holiday tradition was born that this work became a holiday tradition having to do with Christmas rather than Easter. One of the reasons given is that there was a great deal of Easter music available at the time. You had both of J.S. Bach's Passions, along with his Easter oratorio and several others that we could mention. But there was not a big Christmas work other than the Christmas oratorio, which some of you may know is a series of 20 to 25 minute cantatas, all intended for performance on a different day. During Bach's lifetime, there was never a performance of the full Christmas oratorio. So other than that, there was very little to offer. The size of chorus began to matter as festivals in the late 18th century and early 19th century began to take place with huge choruses, 200, 300, 400 voice choirs. There are probably over 20 editions, printed editions of Messiah available today. I would say roughly half are useful and adhere to the notation that Handel intended. And yesterday I looked up, and to my surprise, beginning in 1927 with an early recording of Sir Thomas Beecham until most recently in 2020, Messiah has been recorded 279 times. I could not find out exactly how many of those are available today. I have 5 or 6, so maybe you have even more. In Victorian England, of course, the choruses became huge, as did the orchestration of the piece. It began with Mozart, who in 1789 was asked to give a performance of Messiah in Vienna. And he wanted to use the original orchestration, which Handel authored, which consists of strings, two violin parts, viola, cello, and bass, a continual instrument, harpsichord and organ, two oboes, two trumpets, and a bassoon and timpani. Baron von Swieten convinced Mozart that that would not fly in 1789 Vienna. So Mozart added flutes, clarinets, French horns, and trombones. And thus began the move to much larger festival-type performances. Robert Shaw once conducted the Hallelujah Chorus with 4,000 choristers in the Stockyards in Kansas City, Missouri. In our own time, there was Eugene Goossens, a great conductor, who in Victorian England managed to have these choruses of 2,000 and orchestras of 500 playing the piece. In Handel's time, the orchestra membership always outnumbered the number of choristers because the instruments could not make the big sounds that we are accustomed to today. As I said, the work is a series of ideas or meditations, but they are all connected into scenes. I'm going to play the overture and give you a couple examples of this overture to see how interpretation can be arrived at. Beginning with Beethoven in 1815 or thereabouts with his Eighth Symphony, it's the first time we see metronome markings. There were none before 1815. There were expressive markings and pseudo-tempo markings such as allegro, allegro ordinario, allegro moderato, vivace, etc. We don't know how fast those things went. As we have gone through the 18th, 19th, and and 20th century, tempi have tended to get faster. I have here for you the overture. I will play part of it. First by Sir John Eliot Gardner and the English Baroque soloists and the Orchestra of the Age of Enlightenment. Repeats, and then we have a faster fugal section. We'll come back to Mr. Gardner a little bit later for some choruses. In the 50s, Sir Thomas Beecham, who did that original recording in 1727 and 1728, did some radically fast tempos, such as you heard here from John Eliot Gardner. And it was so different from anything that had been heard in, say, Victorian England and elsewhere, sort of a stodgy, ultra-religioso kind of performance would take place. In Beecham's case, no one had ever imagined these tempi to be so fast. And of course, then in the 60s, we have the performance practice, original instrument, or at least replicas thereof, movement taking place with such people as Sir Nicholas Harnoncourt. And I'd like to play you a bit of his overture. This is with the Concentus Musicus Wien, and when we get later with the chorus, it's going to be the Stockholm Chamber Choir. Sir Nicholas Harnoncourt, the Concentus Musicus Wien, Messiah, the Symphony. Quite different. So that's quite a dramatic interpretation of a Baroque overture. I should say the Baroque overture that we have heard here from George Handel, who was a German composer who lived a lot in Italy and then wound up in England. The form, slow, fast, slow, is borrowed from the French, known as a French overture. Often the slow return is left out, as it is in this case. It ends with the fugue that I started to play for you, and it is followed immediately by a recitative accompagnato. That means there are strings involved, and an aria by the tenor. And these three things leading to "And the Glory of the Lord," the first chorus, are all glued together by key. I'm going to play part of the "Comfort Ye and Every Valley," sung by John Humphrey. And this is a modern day recording, 1984. It's Robert Shaw in the Atlanta Symphony. The reason I'm playing this is because John Humphrey was a teacher of mine about 60 years ago. And I had the great pleasure of hiring him as a soloist on several occasions at Rhode Island College. And I also sang the role of Jesus to his evangelist in St. Matthew Passion at Marlborough. So pardon me, but this has a lot of nostalgic meaning to me. Plus, he's a darn good singer. Notice the fuller sound from contemporary instruments. In the ensuing aria, "Every Valley Shall Be Exalted," there is a lot of word painting, as there will be going forward in most of the choruses and the remaining arias. Pay particular attention, if you will, to what Handel does with the word "exalted." The texts, by the way, are all from Isaiah. The English say Isaiah. The text is, "Every valley shall be exalted and every mountain and hill made low." pay attention to what he does there as well. And the rough places plain. You will hear sort of a little back and forth notation from the violins making the rough places, and then the tenor sings plain. I'll try to peg this as best I can. Exalted. Etc., and followed by the chorus and the glory of the Lord, which is the first chorus in Messiah of many. And I always would tell choruses when we would do this work, which was usually the first work of the season for either the college or the Rhode Island Civic Rowland Orchestra, this is the first time that any audience is going to hear you. So let's make this chorus really work. It's a bouncy thing. We're going back to the John Elliott Gardner recording of it. The pitch might jar some of you who have perfect pitch. In both the John Elliott Gardner versions and the Nicholas Harnoncourt versions, the Baroque pitch of A equals 415 vibrations per second is used. And in Robert Shaw's recording, A 440. So I can't really make the connection as well as I'd like. You the text, I'm sorry. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. Notice what he does every time we come to for the mouth of the Lord. It is unison in octaves. It is very clear that the Lord is speaking. And so on. I'd like next to move still in, I think I'm still in part one. Yes. There is another little scene that begins with a baritone arioso, and that's preceded by a recitative, again accompagnato. A recitative is a lot of words in sentences which advance the plot, both in oratorio and, if there were a plot, and in opera. When it's accompagnato, it means that violins and violas have been added to the basic continuo part, which is cello, bass, and either harpsichord or organ. This text is, for behold, darkness shall cover the earth. I've got it here someplace. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising. Note again the tremendous amount of word painting here on words such as darkness and arise and light, which is followed again for the text from Isaiah. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. And when we see the great light, even though the key is in a minor key, we see the great light in a major key. And I think that will be very obvious to you. And that is followed by the great chorus, for unto us a child is born. Again, I want you to notice the declamatory sense of wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father. There's a great deal of counterpoint in fugal writing up until that point. Also, for unto us a child is born begins very simply. And then when the second voice comes in with the same text, the same notes, the first voice, which entered now on born, has a lot of really fast notes and a lot of scales and a lot of leaps. And I think Handel was intent on showing us what it was like to have a birth. As a matter of fact, Sir Thomas Beecham at one point was conducting a chorus of hundreds at the Leeds Festival. And when it came time for unto us a child is born in the rehearsal, Sir Thomas turned to the soprano section and said, ladies, a little less the labor of birth, a little more the joy of conception. Happens three times with the material passed from the alto to the tenor and finally to the bass, and then the third time to the soprano. Moving on, of course, there's quite a bit more in part one, but I want to show you the connection again for much of what goes on in part two, if I haven't gotten rid of it someplace. I'm going to begin with the first chorus of part two, and in John Eliot Gardner's recording here with the Monteverdi Choir in English Baroque Soloists, he treats the Behold the Lamb of God much more tenderly than some others. And I think for that reason, I sort of like it. It sheds a different kind of light on the thing. That is followed by he was despised. Behold the Lamb of God is from John in the New Testament. And then we go back for a long time, for many verses, to Isaiah 53. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He gave his back to the smiters and his cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. He hid not his face from shame and spitting. And then the chorus re-enters. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. There is infinite variety of word painting once we get into these great choruses. I should say that in the first performance, there was a Mrs. Cibber, who was the mezzo-soprano. When Handel went to Dublin, he took along a couple of female soloists, and the choir in Dublin was made up of two church choirs, both professional. The male soloists and probably one of the alto soloists came from those choirs. Mrs. Cibber was going through a rather scandalous divorce. And after she had sung this great aria, He Was Despised, a clergyman stood up in the audience and said, Madam, for this may all your sins be forgiven thee. Sometimes there's a little bit of humor where you least expect it. Here is Behold the Lamb of God. He was despised, and I'll only play part of that. This aria, the B section, so-called, it's a da capo aria, which means that what you just heard will be repeated, is a rather nasty section. And it the text to which is, he gave his back to the smiters and his cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. He hid not his face from shame and spitting. And the thing to keep in mind, if you will, through all of this section is that it's from Isaiah and it's prophecy from the Old Testament. And the A section repeats, followed by this great chorus. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrow. And I think with the rhythm in the orchestra, you can hear the nails. He was wounded. Listen to the dissonance. Wounded. Transgressions. Is followed by two marvelous choruses, and these three, surely he hath borne our griefs, and with his stripes we are healed, and all we like sheep have gone astray, are all connected, one right after the other. They are segue. There is absolutely no pause. And the first two are in F minor, and then all we like sheep have gone astray is in F major. I'm going to play a part of that, I hope, so you can hear what marvelous word painting Handel does on words like gone astray. And we have turned. Gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. We have turned it. And that is followed by another mini scene consisting of a tenor recitative and a nasty chorus, followed by the most exquisite tenor arias that I think exist. The tenor recitative is, "All they that see him laugh him to scorn," and you can hear the laughing in the orchestra, in the violins, as they play really fast notes. "They shoot out their lips and shake their heads, saying, 'He trusted in God that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him if he delight in him.'" It's a very nasty, mocking chorus. It's the chorus. It's like a tour by or the crowd scenes in Bach's Passions. You'll hear that followed by, "Thy rebuke hath broken his heart." And then a marvelous recitative. Here's the first recitative. "All they that see him..." Nasty.
"All they that see him laugh him to scorn. They shoot out their lips and shake their heads, saying..."
The chorus is the crowd.
"He trusted in God that he will deliver him. Let him deliver him if he delights him. He trusted in God that he will deliver him. Let him deliver him if he delights him.
Followed by,
"Thy rebuke hath broken his heart. He is full of heaviness. He is full of heaviness. Thy rebuke hath broken his heart. He looketh for some to have pity on him. But there was no man, neither found he any, to comfort him. He looked for some who have pity on him. But there was no
to..." Followed by the aria, "Behold and see if there be any sorrow." We need to move on. The next scene is the one which leads to the Hallelujah chorus, and which ends part two. And I'll never forget the first performance I conducted. I went for coffee with some faculty colleagues the next morning and was asked why I did the Hallelujah chorus out of order. Of course, it does not end the oratorio. There are several more movements to go. This section begins with, "Why do the nations so furiously rage together?" And I think Handel captures it beautifully, the raging of the nations. In the original text from the Old Testament, it's, "Why do the heathen so furiously rage together?" Jennings changed it to "nations" to be all inclusive. This again is from Psalms, and then these next movements are from Psalms, Psalms of David, and then the last, Revelations, Hallelujah. The text here is, "Why do the nations so furiously rage together? Why do the kings rise up?" And then the chorus comes in, "Let us break their bonds asunder." And a rather jolly, sort of madrigal-esque type of chorus, followed by tenor, recitative, and aria, "He that dwelleth in heaven," and then "Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron," followed by "Hallelujah." Threatened to cut the Hallelujah chorus, but I won't. There are two wonderful tenor recitative and aria which come before this. "Thou shalt break them in pieces with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel," followed by "Hallelujah." Understated to begin, but it will build. But energetic and sincere.
Hallelujah.
Holidays, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the music. It's a great piece, and I certainly needed my Messiah fix this year above all others, I think. Thanks for coming. If there are any questions, Benedict, I think, will field them and let me know.
Ed, thank you. Thank you so much. I mean, it's just remarkable, the music. We've got a couple young guests here who are listening. let me ask, what was the original group size of the performance in Ireland?
It was about 20 singers, 10 from each chorus and an orchestra of 19.
Okay, well, there you have it, Emma. Here is Angela Fisher is asking, when Handel used themes by Corelli or other composers, were there lawsuits?
None. As a matter of fact, that's a very good question. The rule of thumb of the day was that it was perfect. It was paying a compliment to anybody whose music you used. The rule of thumb was you had to make it better than the original. And in Handel's case, in Messiah, at least, he borrowed some of his own pieces, as I pointed out, with the chorus "For Unto Us a Child is Born." And J.S. Bach borrowed from himself, from Vivaldi, from everybody else. Again, the rule was make it better than the original.
Okay. Well, very much in spirit with the 18th century, where our notions of appropriation and, stealing and taking was quite different back then.
Right, exactly.
So, okay. Any other questions? Speak out. Oh, here's a fourth one. Hold on a second. What is our presenter's favorite recording of the Messiah that is available today?
The one that I made 3 years ago with the Rhode Island Civic Chorale and Orchestra. No, I think it's an interesting question because they all have so much to offer, especially John Elliott Gardner, Christopher Hogwood, Nicholas Harnoncourt, because they are the early music experts, and from them we learn a great deal. For the overall sound, I've been living with the Robert Shaw performances since 1965, and I find it very hard to beat the choral sound of those.
Okay. Well, I want to thank everyone. This wraps up our program for 2020, 26 programs starting last May. We're very pleased that you joined us, and stay tuned for our winter series to be announced very soon. We wish you all happy and healthy holidays. Good evening, and thank you so much, everyone, and certainly Professor Markward, remarkable series. So thank you very much, and good night, everyone.
Pat says good night, too.
Good night.
Good night.